wants more access, energy access to India, and we are also on the lookout for substitutes, because most of the world, you know, barring China to some extent, has been moving away from Iranian oil. So there is an adjustment there, and Trump administration knows about it. But the Trump administration also knows that we have our own geopolitical compulsions. This is a very sophisticated relationship circle. Mm. We are not the type where we are going to kowtow and meekly bow just because the US is doing it, we have to follow their line. No.
No.
We have our own interests, we'll defend those interests, but we look for shared, you know, points of convergence with the US to the extent possible.
Mm. Right. That's important as far as Iran is concerned. But, you know, in the larger strategic realm, the questions regarding Iran, are they, you know, I mean, would they be utilized by the United States in some sort of leverage to get, because in a transactional model of finding deals, anything is on the table, you know, and that is the method that apparently the US president adopts. He doesn't differentiate between what is strategic, what is economic, what is this. He utilizes one to get the other.
Yeah, that's called linkage.
That's called linkage.
It's called linkage,
right, okay.
And cross-issue linkage, that's what Trump often does. Even on North Korea, you know, for example, with China, he has dangled the issue of, you know, solving the North Korea problem in return for settling the trade dispute with China, you know. So these kind of cross-issue linkages do exist. But I think we should be wary of those because, you know, we have our own, you know, geopolitical. That's why I said, see, look at our geography, look at where the U.S. is on a world map.
No, definitely we are wary, but how does one avoid it when they are put on the table?
Well, that's where I said we draw our lead lines,
okay,
and say beyond a point, you know, you cannot force us to stop cooperation. In fact, even on Russia, for that matter, you know, the Trump administration has piled on a lot of pressure to try and, you know, desist us from buying the Russian S-400 anti-missile system. We have not done that.
Sure.
We have stuck to our guns, and we need that, you know. At the same time, the Trump has been talking up the value of the U.S. Anti-aircraft missile defense system, which is not comparable to S-400, but performs other functions.
Right.
We may be willing to buy some of those. So what we're telling, from Trump's point of view, this is the world's biggest arms bazaar.
Yes,
and India should be open to buy more and more and more. And that's why he was trumpeting it. But on the other hand, we will be selective. We will be nuanced. This is Indian diplomacy. You know, it's not black and white for us. There are a lot of gray areas, and we will look for our own national interests and get as much, you know, buy-in from the Americans to that to the extent possible.
Professor, if I can come to you now, your thoughts on the likely outcomes of the delegation-level talks and what might be in it for both the U.S. and India.
Yeah, Ramesh, some of the nitty-gritty, I mean, we know that there's going to be an agreement on intellectual property rights. There's going to be one on homeland security protection. I think these are significant because the U.S. has been complaining for a long time, not just under Trump administration, but for many, many years that, you know, there's not enough copyright protection for their, you know, products and services in India, and that there's rampant piracy. So I think we have, you know, our own legislative process and our own policing under Modi Sarkar. We have improved significantly about the America's ability to finance some of these initiatives. I mean, this has been an open question, you know, especially under President Trump. They have cut down a lot of foreign aid and assistance budget, and State Department, USAID has been struggling. But the interesting point that President Trump mentioned today was that the U.S. International Development Finance Corporation, USIDFC, is going to set up, have a permanent presence in India. So then clearly, you know, and then the question is how much, you know, budget will they have to be able to expend for development projects, because this has been the weak link of the U.S., you know, compared to China. You know, because the Chinese, the kind of checkbook diplomacy they have, the U.S. has not been able to really match it. Even with the 5G, which Trump specifically mentioned, he said we discuss secure network.
Right.
And, you know, the point is Qualcomm and Intel are the only two big U.S. companies that have some patents in 5G. The Chinese companies, ZTE and Huawei, are leading the race, along with Samsung of South Korea. So the U.S. has not been really able to put the money where the mouth is in terms of persuading countries to reject Huawei and ZTE, you know. So they're only reminding interlocutors that, look, you know, it could be a backdoor for the Chinese to spy over your networks. But that's not enough, right? A lot of even U.S. core U.S. allies like Britain have agreed to take on 5G in some of their part of their network.
Mm-hmm.
So both with development finance or with 5G, these are U.S. priorities. They've been advocating very, very loudly about it and trying to dissuade countries from going towards China. But the real question is, Will there be enough finance from the U.S. end? This is where, you know, their private players have to take on the mantle, because the state as a whole is withdrawing and stepping back because Trump has more domestic priorities and is not able to match the Chinese, you know, checkbook for checkbook. And that's where, you know, maybe we should temper our expectations.
And Professor Chaulia, if I can, again, to refer to what Moonmoon said, for the second time in 2 days, we've heard from U.S. President on Pakistan. Yesterday, he spoke about how U.S. wants Pakistan to confront terrorism, to combat terrorism, and he repeated that in his joint press statement beside Prime Minister Modi at Hyderabad House. So where might the U.S. initiative be vis-a-vis Pakistan from India's perspective?
Ramesh, President Trump said something like, we are working productively with Pakistan on this issue. So obviously he is suggesting that, you know, they are applying levers of pressure. Mm-hmm. They have cut military aid, you know, because he was very frustrated with their double game tactics. But on the other hand, you know, they have restored, I mean, the World Bank through the World Bank system and multilateral assistance, which is still dominated by the U.S. They continue to channel, you know, much needed lifelines to Pakistan. And of course, now with the Taliban talks reaching a kind of a crescendo, they continue to rely on Pakistan. So I think Trump has not been as blunt in terms of on the issue of countering Pakistan-based terrorism as much as we would have wanted. But you know, if you take a historical perspective, Ramesh, historically there was a time when U.S. president would even be hesitant to take the word of Pakistan, you know, on our soil when they would visit, because they would be always about, you know, hyphenating and balancing a little bit of this or that. That element is still there, I think, in U.S. policy. But increasingly, they know, you know, this is the market, right? I mean, you saw how when Prime Minister said a lot, in four sectors, he said it reached 70 billion or more, and he said it's all happening under Trump's watch. He was like so happy about it. And then he mentioned the fact that our exports are, you know, booming to India, and you know, he took you know, self-congratulatory smile on his face. So clearly, Pakistan has nothing to give them in terms of a market. You know, so it's like chalk and cheese. As far as the commercial opportunities going, Trump, you know, the ultimate salesman, he's not getting any exports to Pakistan, you know, sold to Pakistan. So as far as corporate America is concerned, as far as business is concerned, it's not only a smaller market than India, but also a failing one. You know, they're on life support with aid and with the bailout packages and all those things. So I think primarily the U.S. lens has shifted from a time when they were thinking of balancing India and Pakistan to now they think of India as a great opportunity for them, and Pakistan as a nuisance or as a troublemaker. But the question is, you know, they use this blackmail strategy, they use their you know, geographical location and the so-called strategic depth in Afghanistan to continue to extract benefits from the US. But one would hope, I think, in the restricted talks, Prime Minister must have raised the issue about, look, now this Taliban deal is being done, now how can we jointly stabilize Afghanistan? If you continue to pamper the Pakistanis, we are never going to get you know, anywhere in terms of stabilizing Afghanistan, because they will try and maintain their hegemony in that, through their proxies, ISIS or Taliban. So I think that is where the proof of the pudding lies, you know, because President Trump has hit the right chords and as we had wanted, but he has not gone full hog, and that suggests that they're holding back and they still are quite cautious with Pakistan. So in other words, the initiative has to remain with us. You know, we cannot depend on the U.S. completely when it comes to solving our core national security threats.
Do you want to weigh in on this, Professor? For instance, Prime Minister Modi said that the commerce ministers of India and U.S. have reached an understanding and that the trade negotiations will continue in the days ahead.
Yeah, and he mentioned that they were going to look to make it, give it a legal shape.
Right.
So obviously that means, you know, nitty-gritty still need to be resolved, you know, a lot of loose ends still. I think on trade, Ramesh, we know, those who understand Trump, you know, it's very, very central to his politics, you know. He came to power on two planks, anti-immigration and protectionism, or what we call neo-mercantilism. This is what defines Trump's politics and his approach to the world, and frankly, all the geopolitics and other things we're mentioning are not his own brainchild, but actually inserted by his advisors and the broader U.S. system. The one that he really cares about is trade, and he has done revised trade agreements with most of the major U.S. partners, Canada, Mexico, China,
Japan,
South Korea. He said Europe is next, and then that leaves India. You know, so I think he is working towards, and he always wants to claim to his voters that, look, they initially had a position, But I am, you know, art of the deal. I am the, like, the greatest deal maker, and I pushed them hard. I extracted more from them, and eventually they acquiesced. And look, I have won one more victory, you know, for the American workers. So I think that's how he's going to look at it. And he did link it to the November elections, even before coming to India, boarding Air Force One. He was saying, well, maybe we'll do it by November, maybe later. A big deal is coming. So he wants to always advertise these trade victories. And I think we know that. You know, I think as we go closer towards November, you might find Trump suddenly becoming more flexible on some of these issues and telling his, you know, trade representative, let's just bury the hatchet and sign it, because he needs it, you know, to show as a major foreign policy victory, much more than a kind of this global comprehensive strategic partnership. For him, frankly, if you understand Trump, all those are just, you know, verbose things. What really matters, the deliverable, the concrete takeaway for him will be trade. So I think we will need to work with him in the coming months. And I'm quite positive that before November, we'll see an announcement.
But why have these deliberations, Sreeram Chaulia, been so painstaking? Because when we thought we are sorting out certain differences, there were fresh differences that emerged. Sources say that U.S. interlocutors did change the goalposts as well. Is it because India was dealing with a president who has the reputation of being transactional? And you spoke about the art of the deal. Donald Trump has been referring in his public statements to how Prime Minister Narendra Modi is a tough negotiator. So he is acknowledging that India is not giving in despite the pressures that may have been put.
Yeah.
So why have these deliberations been so painstaking?
No, that's because Trump is a maximalist on trade, you know, and he believes that the rest of the world has been cheating the U.S., especially developing countries, you know. So he comes with a totally different, you know, opposite antithesis of the liberal perspective.
And now the United States has taken us out from the list of developing countries.
Yeah,
it's
no, so
us developed
in
the context
form,
of global,
you know,
trade.
If not the full GSP, we will want it restored in some form as a symbolic takeaway. And by the way, $6-7 billion, that's almost 12% of our total exports to the U.S. in goods, right? And that's coming out of the GSP. So we have taken a hit, but we have also retaliated. They want some of the tariffs lifted. So even if you see the deal with China, you know, Trump was posturing initially, saying, no, they need to buy more, they need to buy even more than what they promised. $200 billion is nothing, I want more. You know, at one famous cabinet meeting, Trump is supposed to told his aides, the aides told him apparently that, you know, Chinese want to buy $30 billion more from us, you know, of agriculture products. So only $30 billion, make them buy $50 billion. You know, if it's less than $50 billion, I'm not satisfied. And then somebody reminded him that, Mr. President, we don't even have enough of $50 billion worth of agriculture products to sell to China. You know, so what's the point of opening up the market? Like, then he said, it's simple, make them buy farm products, make them buy tractors, American tractors. So I think he's very aggressive on this point. And but one thing he did acknowledge was Prime Minister Modi, a chaiwala, is also very tough. And he said that, he acknowledged as an aside, but I think he knows the inside of what has been going on. He knows that we are not a pushover on trade. And he knows that we will stand our ground. But I think given the political dynamics, for Trump, it's not so much about the actual trade nitty-gritty. It's about wanting to show that I won again on trade, you know, to his voters. So I think we know that, and we know the timeline of what's coming up until his re-election bid. So we will want to leverage it to our advantage.
Sreeram Chaulia, weighing on issues that were not spoken from the lawns of the Hyderabad House, but would definitely have been discussed between the two leaders.
Yeah, no, I just want one additional point about this net provider of security before you go. You know, we have been, as Prime Minister's, you know, core slogan has been Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas. And this is also, you know, basis of our foreign policy towards extended neighbors. And Prime Minister also has a Sagar, security and growth
yes.
for all in the region. And this refers to the entire Indo-Pacific. And if you see our, on the eastern side, we have ramped up significantly with the Pacific Island nations. Because earlier, when we said ACT is, it's only limited to Southeast Asia and Northeast Asia.
Mm-hmm.
So Japan, South Korea on one side, and then, you know, the ASEAN countries on the other. But there is a third element, which is
the Pacific,
you know, Pacific
small, island.
Small island nations. We have done, you know, full multilateral summits with them. And then there's, of course, Australia. So I think we have done better in terms of ACT East compared to look east, in terms of comprehensive coverage. And then towards the east coast of Africa, the other end of the West Indian Ocean, with the Seychelles, with Mauritius, with Madagascar, you know, PM has the Maldives, you know, PM has visited.
And with the French in Reunion Islands, for instance.
With Reunion,
Singapore, Vietnam.
And we are trying to get the Russians in. So there's a lot of activity. Dr. Jayashankar has got worked out a map for, you know, trying to generate this momentum for us to realize Indo-Pacific. There's only one area, Ramesh, where net provider, we have not been able to fulfill the aspirations or expectations of other, which is we did not join RCEP. Mm-hmm. But we had legitimate reasons for not joining RCEP the way it is right now. And we're fully justified, but there's still expectation. Like, frankly, I mean, I was just speaking to a Japanese diplomat, and I asked her, you know, what do you think about the citizenship and all this, you know, these so-called protests that are going on? Said, no, we don't care about any of that. It has not at all hurt India's image at all. What does really, you know, in any way, if we have caused concern, is because you did not join RCEP. So the question is, if you don't join RCEP, are we in a position to do net provider of security and prosperity to all in the region? There is a question mark if we are out of the major regional integration initiative. And I hope that we are still, we have said that our door is open, we're going to renegotiate and re-enter RCEP. Coming to Munmun, the other aspects, the unmentioned aspects, see, whenever US and India get together, it's always a question mark of what India, US, you know, plus a third country could do, you know, and here the Blue Dot initiative, I think that was very significant, but it was not, you know, elaborated, and I think it's worth studying because with Japan and with the US together, now both are comprehensive global strategic partners, we should start announcing initiatives, fresh initiatives, because one thing is BRI is, you know, despite the financing challenges the Chinese are facing due to their economic slowdown, is still, you know, is still active and it is continues to expand its network. On the other hand, we had announced the Asia-Africa Growth Corridor, which has taken a lower profile. All the projects are being undertaken. So I think with Africa, Southeast Asia, and with Japan involved, with the US together, we can do a lot, you know. But the problem has always been with, you know, getting the US involved in these kind of multilateral initiatives under Trump. But I think this visit, we should be able to, you know, kickstart more of the, so triangular and quadrilateral cooperations, you know, not just the quad, it's, we can have multiple combinations. For example, Vietnam, Indonesia, India, United States. You know, these, Indonesia and Vietnam are the two most powerful militaries in among ASEAN countries. They have a, you know, clear and present sense of danger about Chinese hegemony in their backyards, and they have territorial disputes with China and South China Sea. We have not been really able to project power and you know, push back the Chinese expansion with these kind of you know, important Asian countries. They are looking up to India. You know, they expect us to do more to be this net provider of security. So clearly, we have a task cut out in terms of our power projection and for India to become this leading power that the world expects us.
Sreeram Chaulia, what choice does India have? It's an impending agreement that the U.S. is going to sign with Taliban, and they'll be observing less violence, at least for the first 7 days. If the agreement holds after that, remains to be seen. But what choice does India have except to reconcile itself? Any persuasion that India can use at this point in time?
Yeah, you know, one is the coordinated withdrawal. You see, they had not really involved us in any of the talks, you know. Zalmay Khalilzad was simply ex post facto after the, you know, he was occasionally briefing us on this. And even the Afghan government in Kabul was, you know, left out in the lurch, you know, for a long time. So, and this reflects, you know, Trump's isolationism. He wanted to pull out, you know, and he wanted to end the so-called endless wars. So, and Trump has often been saying that, you know, why can't these regional powers over there take care of these matters? Why should we 7,000 miles away worry about, you know, Kandahar or Kabul? So I think that is where, you know, the signal is very clear. You know, he wants to shed the burdens of U.S. global responsibility of being a global supercop or any such thing. And we, you know, in many ways, the onus is on us to fill the vacuum, you know. So how are we going to do it?
How does India fill the vacuum?
Yeah. So, Ramesh, I think the SCO is an important mechanism. We already have a regional, you know, organization where we are full members now, Shanghai Cooperation Organization. U.S. is not there, but Russia and China are there. Even Pakistan is there, but that doesn't matter. All the Central Asian republics bordering Afghanistan are there. We need to brainstorm on what we have been talking about, a, you know, kind of a regional solution or endogenous solution or end game, and it has not really materialized because for all this while we were depending on NATO presence there, you know, directly or indirectly. We would say, okay, NATO is there, NATO will do the fighting, we do the other nation building aspects. But now, you know, the fighting also and the peacekeeping You see, after the deal comes a peacekeeping phase. If we, even if we don't put boots on the ground, we should enable our Central Asian partners and others. And China is the key, because, you know, if the Chinese have the resources, we had actually agreed China, India plus one, and we had started training Afghan diplomats and civil servants along with China. You know, so there are innovative ways by which we need to build small group coalitions to try and stabilize that country. If the US is pulling out, then, you know, frankly, we have to reduce our sense of dependence on them, strategic dependence. They cannot solve our strategic dilemmas on some aspects, you know. Therefore, in fact, it's interesting that Trump did not mention the Afghan withdrawal at all so far while being in India in public remarks. So he's hell-bent on getting out. So that is where, you know, the limits of this partnership. Although there are so many positives with India and the US, we must be prepared for what I call a post-American world order that's emerging.